Prashant for having me here, and Mansi, I'm really inspired by your story. It really requires a lot of guts to do whatever you're doing today. Hats off to you. And as regards to my journey, I'll give a very brief, quick run through of my journey. So I was a very simple next door girl kind of a thing, without much of ambition, no career focus. I was very brought up in a very simple environment, and somehow I got married at an early age of 19 and to an army officer. So for me, getting married into an army family, getting married to an army officer was a big, big deal, because I had never seen anyone directly in army. So it was, I had heard only army stories. So it was a beautiful marriage of 4 years. And in that 4 years of marriage, I was blessed with a baby boy. So after 4 years of marriage, my husband was posted in Jammu and Kashmir. And while he was in Jammu and Kashmir, in a terrorist encounter, he got killed. He killed 4 terrorists, but in that bargain, he had to sacrifice his life. He was awarded Kirti Chakra posthumously. So now after his demise, you know how our Indian society is and how we girls are made to feel that now what will happen to you, how your life is going to be. And with a small child, it was very difficult for me to understand actually what is going to happen to my life and what am I going to do with my life. So the first thought, I think it's a very normal human psychology, that the first thought you get is to just quit your life or just quit from that situation. So I was also into that verge, like, now my husband is not there, I have no existence and I don't want to live, or I can't live my life. Who will take care of me? Who will be there for me to fend me? So all these thoughts were like eating me up, and I definitely decided to give up on life. But then I saw my 2-year-old son, and he was too small to understand what has happened, that his dad has gone, mom has lost her senses to take care. So in all this bargain, someone told me that, why don't you join army? And when that person, who was very close to my husband, when that person told me that, why don't you give a try to join the army? So I thought, like, he's just making a fun of me, because I was a very, very delicate girl. Like, if I'll go out in the sun, I will feel sick. So I was that delicate. I had never done any sport in the school, never participated into any adventure kind of a thing where any physical stamina is required. So I really thought that it is not for me. And he said, no, that you are meeting all the eligibility criteria to join the army, but you have to pass the exam, you have to appear for the exam, you have to do the training, because on that front, nobody is going to help you. You have to do it on your own, but if you try, you can. So I just slept with that thought, because I for sure knew I can't do it. It's not my cup of tea. But then what gave a thought to me after thinking about it, that maybe this is a way I can, if I get to wear the uniform, I can be with my husband. My son can get a feel that, oh, his dad is still there. And with all those thoughts, after 3 months of my husband's demise, I appeared for the army entrance exam. And I just prepared for that exam for a week. I broke my nose also for preparing for that exam. I was trying to jump a ditch and all, you know, I had never done all those things. And the trauma of losing my husband was so fresh in my mind. Everything I was doing was very, very challenging for me. But somehow, God willing, I was able to clear the exam. And within 6 months of my husband's demise, I reached academy. So I was very thrilled when I reached the academy, because I thought, I've reached the academy, I've become an officer. I never realized that I have not even done anything to become an officer. I have to undergo the 6 months of training. That was one part. And second part was that I had to leave my son with my parents back home. I had to go for the training in Chennai, and my son had to be in Kanpur. I'm talking of 2002. At that time, mobile phones were also not there. So for me to communicate to my son for next 6 months was going to be a challenge. I can't even meet him. So all these things made it very difficult for me to be at the academy. And when I started doing the training, it was beyond my mental and physical capacity. Like, within a week I thought I can't do it and I need to go back home. I don't just care what people think. I can't do this. The training was so difficult for me. But then whenever the thought of quitting was there, I always used to think that I can't quit. I can't be so weak that my husband has done something so big and gone. I can't be such a weak wife. So I will go back from here as an officer. If I can't do the training, if I have to die, I'll die here. Because everything that requires your physical capacity, you feel that, oh, you will die. So I said, let me die. If I have to die, I'll die here doing the training. But then I think the mental strength was more important. And I could, with all my mental strength, that gave me a lot of physical stamina also. And I could clear the training. And within 6 months, within 1 year of my husband's demise, I became an army officer. And you know, the best part was when my husband was awarded gallantry award, I went to receive it from late Shri Abdul Kalam ji. And I was wearing uniform. That is the proudest moment, you know, because when I walked up to the podium to receive the award, I was in uniform. And it was a lot of sense of pride was there in me, but also a lot of sorrow was also there because I never thought that maybe he would have been there to receive the award on his own. But maybe if I felt that I am walking with him he is within me with that uniform. So that feeling was like so strong. That till date, I get goosebumps when I feel that walk of like, it was just a 30-second walk from my seat till the podium. But till date, it is so fresh in my mind. So after doing my tenure in Army, you know, I quit Army, took a VRS, and I started in corporate work. And then, you know, I met with a very bad road accident, extremely bad road accident where I got 17, 18 fractures. My leg was broken, hand was broken, back was broken, collarbone was everything. You think of a body part and that was broken, and I was straight away bedridden for 1 year. And the worst part was doctor told that I can't, like I from the bed, after 1 year I moved to a wheelchair and then I started walking with the support. And I got a lot of implants in my body. I still have a lot of damages which are like permanent. So after I got into Army, I developed a passion for running. I was not a big time runner, but I started enjoying running. So after my accident, doctor said, you can never run. And I was very fond of wearing high heels. And he said, you can't wear heels also because of leg injury. So these two things, I was very sad over. How will I live? Like, for me, it was like, I can't run. I can't wear heels. They gave me like very much difficulty. How will I deal with it? But I thought, okay, he said, I can't run. But I registered myself to the Airtel Marathon. It had just started that time. He said, you can't do. You just can't do. So I said, I'll try. And I couldn't do it. Honestly, I could just walk like 150 or 200 meters and my legs swell very badly. And I came back. And instead of quitting, you know, at that night, what thought came to me? That doctor said, I can't do anything. I can't walk, I can't run. But I could do 150 meters, 200 meters. So that is an achievement for me. Had I been sitting at home, I couldn't have done that also. And from there, I started picking my all scattered pieces and I started walking. I started with a walk like every day, 100 meters, 200 meters. And slowly, within 2 years, 3 years, I never realized how I got to running, jogging and running. And now today I'm running marathons. That is like my biggest achievement where I was told that I can never run. I started running. And after this, a few more setbacks came to life. I lost my dad all of a sudden, which again pushed me into some trauma and depression. But then a few of my friends told me that why shouldn't I participate in a pageant, and like people should know, people should get inspired. Like a lot of people lose hope in life with everything. And again, I thought that's not my cup of tea because being in army, you are totally different from the beauty world. And it was like, I was just away from all these things. But then again, I thought, why not? This is just one life. We are getting a very less chance in this life to to do things and experience things. So I will do it for myself. I will just experience that pageant. And I participated with no thought of winning or losing, just to have an experience. And God willing, I came out as a winner. That was also one of the very nice moments, you know, because when my name was announced as a winner, I was so clueless, because I was very sure I'm not going to win, because there were so many girls from all the parts of the different part of the world, and also well trained, and I had to do my job, take care of my home, child. So I had hardly prepared. But when my name was announced, you know, and my girl standing next to me, she told me, "It's your name, go." So I couldn't believe it. And with that, I also realized that if you put your sincere efforts, it's not important that what clothes you're wearing, how much your makeup is good, and it is how sincerely you put in your efforts. And the most important thing is that if you stop competing with others, you have to believe that you are your own competition. Half of the time we try and compete with others and see ki unka kya kam hai ya unka kya acha hai, hum unse zyada aur acha kar le. So it is always important that we work on our shortcomings and we improve our own whatever is good in us. So that will also help us to achieve whatever we want. So that is how life is moving on. My son is now 20 plus. He is doing BTech from Mumbai. And things are going fine. I do take care of a lot of war widows, because being myself a war widow, I realize how much it is important to stand on our feet. It is a very traumatic experience to lose your loved one just like that into a war or on a battleground. It is not easy for the children, for the family, for the parents. So I took it as a responsibility that it is very important for me that to take care of these families, to take care of the ladies. I also do a lot of work for slum children, and I'm a big time animal lover. So I do take care of some stray dogs. I have two pets at home. That's how life is going on, as much as I'm able to help people. And I try to do that. And that's all how life is. Thank you. There was a time when I decided to quit on life with my son, when everybody had filled in my head that you can't live your life without a man, or your husband is gone, what will you do now, who will take care of you? So I had seriously thought of quitting life, just giving up on life. I don't want to live anymore. And there was a thought whether I should die alone or I should die with my son. That was the thought I was contemplating. Like, I had started contemplating that I'll die, and I was only thinking whether to die alone or with my son. And, you know, then I was also taking ideas that how should I finish myself. You know, that was also important, that when you have to die, you have to think of ways how you want to die. And then I realized that how can I be so insane, or how can I be so stupid that I am wasting so much of my time thinking of ways which are not so easy, and which will not leave anybody happy about it. And it is going to give a lot of pain to me and my son too. So the amount of time I'm wasting on these things, why not I put a positive thought process? Because I just realized at that point of time, quitting is difficult, living is easy. The if you waste your time thinking how to quit, better is to put the same time in leading a life which can change your life. And that was the point when I was deciding how to quit my life. I decided, no, quitting is not the answer. I have to hit back on life, and I have to get up again, and I have to do, definitely there has to be support from your family and your well-wishers. You can't do things alone. I had my parents back all the time. Till date, my mother, I've lost my dad, my mom is still there who supports me. But that one thought that said that you can't quit. It is very difficult to quit. It is very easy to live your life. And that lives with me today also, that if wherever I am stuck, when I was bedridden, I was also in the same situation of Mansi, where I was sleeping onto one side because my entire right side was broken, because I fell from a height, so my entire right side was broken. So I was only on my left side. And for many months, I was lying like that. So all those times I always felt that I have to get up and do it. I have a tattoo which says till I rise, which means that whatever will keep coming to me, I will rise, I will bounce back. So I never give quitting a thought. That one thing that keeps motivating me, that you have to keep your mind positive, that's all. There will be days which will not be the way you want. There will be stressful days. We are also human beings. We have our happy days, low days. Everything starts from here. And now I believe my head is on the top, because everything has to start from here, because your brain has to be positive. So I definitely try and keep my head very positive. And your physical, whatever you do, this has to be taken care of. Physical stamina also you get from your hair only. It's not by eating a lot of protein or carbs. It is by keeping your mind strong. That's all I would like to say.